Okay, so today we'll talk about the mysterious Africa, the architecture of Africa, a continent which deserves, in my opinion, in the field of architecture to be known better. What I'm going to show is just a sketch, literally, about some examples of what we call African architecture. As I said, this is not an original material. I found the website where, and you can have access to that website as well, where I discovered 54 examples of African architecture and short descriptions of each one of them. And I will mention the name of the writer who made the descriptions. Is this person, Alex Bressler, and I think in 2020 he prepared this material, which can be found on this website, matadornetwork.com. Read the best African architecture. Well, there I myself, and I'm not an expert in African architecture, but I know other buildings from Africa which were not shown here. And any selection is subjective. But, you know, again, this is just an introduction to a vast subject. After this presentation, I will make another presentation about Dogon architecture. In my opinion, a formidable architecture from Mali. And not just architecture, the whole culture there is extremely original and, in my opinion, very inspiring. So, 54 structures that prove African architecture is widely underrated. And I would agree, it is underrated, and it's time to wake up. Because, you know, not what we find in our glossy journals and our glossy websites from the West, usually, and of course, Japan and China, and a little bit from other countries. This does not cover the whole world. Anyway, let's begin. Africa, this is what this person wrote. Africa is big. 54 countries big, approximately 11.7 million square miles, or 20% of Earth's land area, big. Roughly 1.3 billion people, 3,000 indigenous groups, and 2,000 languages, big. To say nothing of its age, with a human history that began some 200,000 years ago, and since witnessed the rise and fall of empires, survived political wars and religious conflicts, seen colonizations and reclamations of identity. In a few words, I think much is being said here. Okay, let's move forward. First, so there are 54 buildings, both from the past and the present, that this person chose from various parts of Africa. And it's kind of like a constellation of examples of buildings that he thought represent Africa in its architectural achievements. So this is, first I show a picture. This is the procedure used also in the website. First, the image of the building, and then the description of the building. It could have been perhaps the other way around, but we can easily move from one to the other. So first, Limoges, and then Le Mans. Deep in the Algerian Sahara is the Mansab Valley, sorry for the pronunciation, a desert oasis housing a pentapolis of ancient fortified cities. Berber followers of Ibadi Islam, known as Mozabites, established these cities, or Ksur, during the 10th century, and their impressive preservation earned the valley a UNESCO inscription in 1982. Gardaya, one of the five Ksur, showcases traditional Mzab architecture through its still standing clay and gypsum structures, among them this Gaudi-esque palace. So let's look at it again. Is it bad? I don't think so. You know, I mean, you know, a simple means, essentially clay, it's a palace, no? And I think it's rich, it's complex, and I'm not sure our buildings are better. Anyway, we move forward. Now, I don't know if this is, you know, from 1,000 years ago, that is 10 centuries ago, but if it is, it's even more remarkable. Let's read again. Is it so? Because somehow I myself am in disbelief that this is from 1,000 years ago, but this is some. This is what I kind of understood from here. And yeah, it's an ancient fortified city, the citadel in a way, and it is impressive. And you know, you might like citadels or you might not like them, but and it shows not just culture, but I would say also civilization. Imagine that something like this was built 1,000 years ago. Okay, moving forward. The Currency Museum in Angola. Now this is a modern is this museum, and here is a bank, which is, you know, an older building. But you see, Africa is not just, you know, clay huts. It has also an urban culture, you know, sometimes significantly developed. Let's read what this writer wrote about this. Across the street from the National Bank of Angola, another of capital city Luanda's landmark sits this striking currency museum. Well, you know, currency has to do with money, I guess. So, you know, I'm not very enthusiastic about money in general, but let's continue to read. Together backdropped by the harbor front, the two buildings exemplify two eras of Angolan architecture. The bubblegum pink bank nods to the nation's Portuguese colonial past, while the museum reflects the modern aesthetic of local architecture firm Costalops. The bulk of the currency museum was built below Major Sadi Minga Square, with the above ground roof doubling as a modern monument in downtown Luanda. I personally like more the, you know, the rural architecture actually of Africa and older buildings, but I mean, much older buildings. But we cannot ignore the fact that Africa also has a present day culture and a present day architecture, and sometimes strikingly modern. Okay, the Tata Somba houses in Benin. Tata Somba houses in Benin. These I love. Now you could say this is no civilization. We cannot live like this. But one thing is for sure, these buildings didn't generate the climate change, didn't generate pollution, didn't generate all the problems we are confronted with. In their modesty, I think they didn't irritate nature, they didn't irritate the air, they didn't irritate the sky, they didn't irritate the gods. But we don't think about the gods today. We have cars, we have highways, we run on those highways madly with our cars, and we do not stop. The only stop we contemplate now is Mars, to go to Mars. After we ravish the Earth, we want to go to Mars. And on Mars, you know, whatever Mr. Musk might say, there isn't enough atmosphere and there isn't enough gravity, and You certainly cannot run a bicycle in shorts on Mars, nor on the moon. But, you know, people are disgusted with the Earth, so they want to leave it. Well, these people here live modestly, but I think much more gracefully than we do. The Somba people of Northwest Benin are known for being skilled builders. Traditional Somba dwellings are mighty earthen fortresses called Tata Somba houses. They are typically two stories tall and have mud walls, straw roofs, and turrets like you might see on a castle. Though similar to the Tekiete structures found in neighboring Togo, Tata Somba houses uniquely have designs engraved on both inner and outer walls. These abstract geometric patterns are hand-drawn by Somba women and viewed as symbols of fertility and prosperity. Nothing can be more foreign to us, so-called civilized modern people in Europe in the 21st century, than this. What do you mean, symbols of fertility and prosperity? What do you mean, designs engraved on both inner and outer walls? Aren't we supposed to just make white walls without any kind of designs engraved on both sides of them? Well, this is what we learn, no? In our schools, that's what we learn, white walls, the more the better. No designs engraved on both sides of the walls, no ornaments, no beauty essentially. We just need white walls and the obsession with its majesty, space. Space, space, and space again, and nothing else. Structure and space, structure and space, structure and space, and no ornament and no time. Certainly no symbolism, no symbols of fertility and prosperity. This belongs to the so-called primitive people. But in my opinion, those who are truly primitive is us. We are primitive because we reduced architecture to structure and space. No mythology, no symbolism, no ornamentation, nothing but structure and space. And analysis. We are very good at this, analysis. The more analysis, the better, but no synthesis. Well, you know, again, we can laugh. We can say, if you make now in a school of architecture a round building like this modest hut here, you would be dismissed because there is no money. You are told that we have no money to build on a round plan, because it's expensive and because we are rational, we have to use right angles. But are these people, were these people rich? How come they built many round buildings? Look here, you know, how come they afforded the cylinder and the round plan when indeed they were extremely poor compared to us? But I think if we are poor in anything, it's not in money, it's in imagination. We don't have imagination. We don't express our inner world. We are just stuck in our so-called enlightened rationalism and functionalism, which is dry, dry, and sterile and frigid. When are we going to end? These people, look, just three, you know, little, I don't even know, there are three families here, or But there is more imagination here than in us in a whole section of a big city. Yes, they are modest structures, but I love them. In their modesty, they say a lot about the poetry of living on this earth, even if you are poor. Okay, moving forward. I don't know what this is in Botswana. Well, this is, you know, this is not necessarily the kind of architecture I like the most, but this constellation of choices that this writer presented shows works of various cultures and times and places in Africa. So this is one of them. Though Christianity is the predominant faith in Botswana, religions ranging from Islam, Hinduism, and Quakerism to Baha'i and Badimor are also practiced. Did you notice how almost every description makes some reference to something having to do with spirit? Can we say the same thing about our buildings? Not at all. The very word spirit is banished. This cheery temple in the nation's capital represents the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, otherwise known as the Hare Krishna Movement. Among the temple's many adornments are twin tiger sculptures guarding the front and the giant lotus flower hanging over the entrance. Again, this is a language which we almost don't understand. What do you mean, you know, tiger sculptures? What do you mean a giant lotus flower? What do you mean, this exotic, spiritualism, you know, Krishna consciousness, even the word consciousness? Are we using this word in our schools of architecture? I doubt it. I don't think there is one single program or theme for a project in any school of architecture that mentions the word consciousness, as if we human beings so-called developed as we are only stomach and pocket. We only eat and sleep and make money. There is no question of what we call consciousness. The painted Gurunsi houses of Tiebele, I don't know where these places are, Burkina Faso, but look at them. Now I'm asking you, how come that these poor people with little money afforded round buildings? How come that we cannot do the same because we are condemned to consider the so-called budget, that we cannot do a round building? But how come these people build frequently, in this way? How do you explain it? Also, how do you explain this rich ornamentation, which is otherwise is abstract? You know, how come we cannot do this? Not only that we cannot do it, because we actually can do it, but it doesn't even cross our mind to do it. Why? Because of the dogma of a very passé modernism, which happened more than 100 years ago, when a man with problems himself, that is Adolf Loos, wrote about the murdering aspects of ornament. But on the other hand, Adolf Loos didn't have any problem to use a marble which was highly ornamental by nature. And so did Mies van der Rohe in the pavilion in Barcelona. If you look at the interior of the building, you'll discover large surfaces of wall, again, made of marble, with a very, very rich, insistent ornamentation, natural ornamentation. Now you tell me, how come that no school of architecture here doesn't even pronounce the word ornament? Please make me understand this, because if you eliminate ornament from the history of architecture, you almost eliminate all architecture. But this is an example of so-called primitive people who needed beauty, who needed complexity, who needed symbols, who needed mythology, but not us. We are emancipated, developed, modern beings. We don't need any of this nonsense. It's not nonsense, not at all. In my opinion, these people were more sophisticated than we are, and certainly more sensitive. And they didn't pollute the air as we do, nor did they provoke the climate change. We do. In the village of Tiebele, which is occupied by the Kasena people of the greater Gurunsi ethnic group of Ghana and Burkina Faso, there exist hand-painted houses dating as far back as the 15th century. These simple yet elaborate structures called sukala are found in the chief's complex and feature designs drawn by Gurunzi women. Again, women, you remember two or three buildings before, again, the women were mentioned in connection with you know, the ornamental work relating to certain buildings, while men are customarily responsible for the building. Materials like mud, chalk, clay, coal, and the lacquer made from beans are used to create the black, white, beige, and red structures, some of which serve as mausoleums. Let's look back at them. You know, I mean, you know, I feel ashamed and dwarfed by the beauty, the complexity of these otherwise modest structures. You know, and I'm dwarfed by the pathetic rationalism that we are still indulging in, which has no poetry, which has no invention, literally, you know, and we are so proud of our achievements. We shouldn't be so proud, actually. In Burundi, let's see what this is, champignon. This is a Bauhaus, it's described as the Bauhaus style building, but, in my opinion, the so-called Bauhaus spirit is misunderstood, because we think of the Bauhaus only about the last period of the Bauhaus, but not the beginnings of the Bauhaus, when actually Walter Gropius worked with Adolf Meyer, and they created some works which were actually expressionistic, almost mystical. And mystical is the manifesto of the Bauhaus, written in 1919 by Walter Gropius. And that manifesto ends with the word faith. And twice in that short manifesto, the word heavens is used. Heaven, yes, heaven. Can you imagine an architect today talking about the heaven? No way. No way. Plus, the graphic representation of the manifesto, which was drawn or incised, it's an engraving by Lionel Feininger, represented the so-called Cathedral of Socialism. Cathedral of Socialism. Can you believe it? So we talk about the Bauhaus, but we actually don't know the Bauhaus. We think that the Bauhaus is just the last phase of the Bauhaus. It's true that the Bauhaus evolved or the opposite towards some kind of, approximately international style architecture, if I can call it so, you know, rather, you know, functionalist, but that's not how its beginning was. The Bauhaus at the beginning didn't even have architects in the school, except Walter Gropius, who himself was a quasi-architect in a way. He was the son of an architect. He never got a diploma in architecture. Well, it happens that he was a good architect, but a good architect who couldn't draw. But he had a very astute intelligence towards bringing brilliant people together. So the Bauhaus began by him inviting brilliant painters like Paul Klee and Vasily Kandinsky and Johannes Eaton to teach in his school, in this school. There were no architects at the beginning, it's just him. Strangely, you know, this brilliant artist actually taught, you know, future, you know, sometimes future architects. Well, not too many architects emerged from this school, but it was a holistic school. It was a school which attempted to unite all the arts for the building of the future. If this building in Africa is truly, for example, this kind of entrance would have been inconceivable by the Bauhaus in its later years. Maybe at the beginning, also this kind of window. In a way, this building was more complex than what the so-called real Bauhaus envisioned. It's more naive in a way, but also more you know, gently, not gentle, no, it's not the correct word, is it has a certain naivete which actually is charming. And yes, you can tell that it was an influence coming from modernity. I don't know if, I'm not sure that the word Bauhaus has to be, you know, attached to the description of this house. Anyway, as you can see, Africa was also the recipient of influences coming from other parts of the world. And let's read the text. Bauhaus architecture arrived in Burundi, a Belgian colony, until 1962, around the mid-20th century. Several examples of the style exist in Bujumbura, the nation's largest city, while Le Champignon, so coined for its resemblance to a mushroom, offers one example in the capital, Gitega. Photographer Jean whatever Molitor, who has captured Bauhaus architecture all around the world, describes the former residence as idiosyncratic, a little playful and individual, noting that the interior design is equally striking and flooded with light. Now, again, I'm very suspicious of generalizing, you know, and this so-called Bauhaus architecture, in my opinion, is very misunderstood. And, you know, as a proof, please search for the first house that Walter Gropius built with Adolf Meyer, and you'll see that it has nothing to do with what we imagine that Bauhaus architecture is. Now, Palazzo do Pogo, Cabo Verde. Now, this is indeed a palace. It's pink, it's a pink palace. You know, what could be more abhorrent? But it has a colonial flavor, of course. There were many colonists in Africa from all over the continent. The European tigers, you know, attacked Africa, and of course, for its riches, they built palaces, they brought Bauhaus there, if you want to call it so, and all kinds of, you know, less than genuine influences. But, you know, I think Africa survived this onslaught of the Europeans. This bright pink Portuguese, you know, Romanians are very proud of Portuguese architecture. Well, you know, they were colonists. They colonized and they brought their, you know, colonial architecture to a culture which they should have left in peace. It was built in downtown Mindelo, a city on the island of São Vicente, towards the end of the 1800s. It was originally called the Palacio do Governo, or Government Palace, though the name was changed to the People's Palace after Cabo Verde won its independence. Today, it hosts a regular rotation of cultural exhibits and shares its landmark status with Mindelo's characteristic pastel, bombalina, neoclassical structure. Forward, reunification monument. Cameroon, it is a monument, no doubt, maybe too explicitly. But this shows again, you know, the variety of buildings in Africa. It's a monument. Cameroon has a long and complicated colonial history. It was occupied by German settlers in the late 19th century and later claimed by both French and British troops after World War I. It remained divided between French Cameroon and British Cameroon until 1960, when the former gained its independence. British Cameroon soon followed suit, reuniting with the rest of the country in 1961. This monument was erected in the capital city of Yaounde the next decade, with the different colors blending together to represent unification. Notre Dame of Bangui, Central African Republic. Well, you know, what can I say? You know, this is an architecture that, for my taste, is too official, too institutional, but Africa has these sort of things as well. Fortunately, look what is behind. the beautiful, rich, dense nature, known in full as the Cathedral Notre Dame de l'Immaculée Conception. This Roman Catholic cathedral towers over Bangui, the capital of the Central African Republic. Of course, the Catholics had to invade Africa as well, you know, because we think that the local spiritual practices and the local faith was inferior, but I don't think it was. I think animism and all the forms of faith of old Africa had the richness and the value which must be recognized again. And actually Mircea Eliade valued them very, very deeply. Its architecture is reminiscent of many structures found in former French colonies with tropical climates, from the use of red brick to the tall towers erected on other side. Built in the mid-1900s, was solidified as a national icon after appearing on a 1964 stamp. Forward. I love this. This is what I love, not those, colonial, imports. Mud huts of Gaoui, Chad, traditional mud huts of Chad. I mean, I would gladly live in such buildings. Now, who knows, as Fernando Pessoa said, it must be beautiful in Australia as long as we don't go there. Maybe we could say the same thing here. It must be beautiful to live in these buildings as long as you don't go there. Who knows? But do you notice they don't have doors? Well, I guess they don't have the fear of thieves. They don't have locks, they don't have keys, they don't have doors. They just have openings, of course, in the wall in order to enter. How convenient, I don't think you need a psychotherapist if you live in such structures. Plus, they are made of earth, of clay. And it seems we are kind of made of clay ourselves, if not dust. So, yes, I idealize. I see, I'm aware of this. It's very possible I idealize. But look at these. I mean, aren't they graceful and, poetical? Frank Lloyd Wright said that architecture is not difficult as long as you don't have to handle the windows. Well, where are the windows here? Are these openings somehow, taking part of the function of possible windows? I don't know. But they were born for a specific culture, a specific climate, and these people knew what they were doing. And, we talk about sustainability. Well, this is true sustainability, not the nonsense that Sir Norman Foster names sustainability using a very, very expensive and complex and actually in essence polluting technology. Because, even the electrical cars of Elon Musk, they consume energy as well. Electrical energy, but electrical energy is not an angel. Itself, it provokes pollution. So, what is truly sustainable? I think these people, of course, we have such an incredible population on Earth. The numbers are immense. We cannot house the whole world in this way. I'm aware of this. But maybe we can reflect a little on this way of life, which for us seems to be primitive, but from a different perspective, perhaps is not primitive at all. Found in the Sahel that connects the Sahara Desert to the Sudanian savanna, the village of Gaoui, the former capital of the Sao civilization, plays host to some of the finest examples of Chad's vernacular architecture. The village's earthen huts are made primarily of mud and straw, and many feature painted embellishments. What? Let me read again, because I don't believe my eyes. And many feature painted embellishments? What is this? This must be on the moon or on Mars. This is not, this cannot be on Earth. Like colorful trim lining the top, bottom, and entryway. Oh, no, no, obviously these people didn't study in architecture schools, because architecture schools would totally reject this kind of nonsense, painted embellishments. This is really unbelievable, unacceptable. It should be illegal. Painted embellishments, like colorful trim, lining the top, bottom, and entryway. Yes, they are indeed primitives. Grand Mosque di Coni, Comoros. This is grand, it's true. And I don't care too much about the mosque, but I care about this, urban fabric, if I am to call it so, or the density is unbelievable. It's true. But this makes me think somehow of the theory of Deleuze and Guattari about the rhizomic culture. I think we can learn, as opposed to the pyramidal, structure, which in this case is kind of symbolized by this mosque. Here is the rhizomic or rhizomic culture. And I think we need more of this than egocentric and the centric mosque, which claims power and prestige and position. I love the periphery. I love the proletarians. I love the poor people. Well, I don't know if these are very poor. I see some houses here which seem to be, rather opulent for the, all in all, there is some unity here, some democracy somehow, as opposed to the monumental mosque. Anyway, should I reach? Let me read. Comoros is an island nation in the Indian Ocean that's made up of three islands. Iconi is a small town on the largest island, aptly called Grand Camore. Mosques are common throughout Comoros, as the majority of its residents practice Sunni Islam. Pictured is the Grand Mosque of Iconi. Maybe we should eliminate for a while from our language this word, grand. I think it's a very unsustainable word, grand. I think we should have less and less of so-called grand things of any sort. Architecturally speaking, the town is also known for hosting the ruins of the Palais de Cavino. Anyway, this is obviously written by this text by a European or a Westerner, built as the seat of the Sultanate of Bambao in the 16th century. Forward, St. Paul's Cathedral, Côte d'Ivoire. Now please be prepared for a surprise, because here comes an Italian architect. Look at this, and actually it's not bad. I like it. Yes, it's a Western invention, it's a Western creation, it's an Italian architect, but I think the building is rather good, And let's read. This Roman Catholic cathedral in Abidjan catches the eye with its distinctive futuristic design. Again, just like with the Bauhaus, here we use the word futuristic without actually thinking too much about what it means. The work of Italian architect Aldo Spirito. I never heard of him, but this building is not too bad. Not only does a massive cross appear to hold up the sloping structure via cables, but the interior also features six stained glass murals and intricate mosaic panels that incorporate both biblical and locally inspired imagery. Though not as large as the Basilica of Our Lady of Peace in Ivorian capital, Yamoussoukro, the largest cathedral in Africa, St. Paul's Cathedral, ranks among the runners-up. Of course, the dimensions are the most important things. It's not about dimensions, it's about quality. And I think that the building has some quality. But anyway, it was designed by an Italian architect. Moving forward, I love huts. And here they are again, Afar huts. Look at them. You might say I have a distorted psychology, but I wouldn't mind living in something like this. Do you see any car? No. Do you think that all these huts provoke any pollution? No. They are not built with concrete. They don't insult nature. Yes, nature here might not be so impressive. You don't see any vegetation, or almost no vegetation. But the modesty of these huts, I think, should inspire us. You know, after all, do we need a lot? Do we need a lot in order to live gracefully on this earth? I don't think so. The Afar people of the Horn of Africa inhabit parts of Ethiopia, Eritrea, and Djibouti. The traditional tent-like dwellings are made by constructing circular. Did I read correctly? Circular? Again, make me understand, because I know anything circular in our schools of architecture is rejected as being expensive. Well, how come all these, obviously, people living with modest means build circular frames and circular buildings much more often than rectangular ones? Please, someone try to explain this to me. Okay, frames from thin branches. Thin branches, they are thus actually underlining the truth of Gottfried Semper's theory about the first building ever built. Then covering the structure in mats woven from locally sourced materials. Pictures are a series of Afar huts set up on the beach of Devil's Island in this eastern, I hesitate to pronounce. So what we see here, since we talk so much about sustainability, is truly a sustainable form of habitation. Now, of course, these huts don't have living rooms, don't have kitchens, don't have refrigerators, don't have the paraphernalia of comfort that we never have enough of, don't have microwaves, don't have all those things that it seems we cannot live without, it seems. You know, and we keep inventing them, you know. Tour de Changeur, Democratic Republic of Congo. Yes, of course, I mean, you know, symbols of power need to be present everywhere. But, you know, look at the bridge. It has some interesting features here on the sides, which seem to be rather, you know, suspiciously capricious. Anyway, the tower is indeed a tower, and apparently it's very, very, very tall. Cheekily referred to as the Kinshasa Eiffel Tower, this nearly 700-foot exchange tower, so that's more than 200 meters tall, sits at the entrance of the Democratic Republic of the Congo's capital, Kinshasa. It was designed to honor the nation's first prime minister, at the request of former president, who also envisioned the tower as a symbol of the city. Since its completion, the tower has fulfilled Seko's wish, featuring in various works by Congolese artists, notably the paintings of, okay. Cairo Citadel, Egypt, Cairo Citadel in, we call it a citadel. Cairo has many important and interesting buildings, not just the famous pyramids nearby. Ancient Egyptian architecture is not all pyramids and temples. Standing atop a hill like a sentinel watching over Cairo is a medieval citadel commissioned by Saladin, the first sultan of Islamic era Egypt. It was built in the 12th century to protect the city from crusaders and served as a seat of government for nearly a millennium. So it's quite an old building. It's older than Chartres Cathedral. Inside the complex are multiple mosques, palaces, and museums. Today, the view from the Cairo Citadel is not only juxtaposed by the city's modern architecture, but also offers a glimpse of the Giza pyramids, weather permitting. Torre de la Libertad, Equatorial Guinea. Well, again, another modern structure advocating explicitly, power, a symbol of the independence of Equatorial Guinea from Spain. All these Europeans actually invaded Africa and took lots of riches from Africa, and that's how they built their own riches back in Europe. And now they advocate democracy and liberté, égalité, fraternité, but not too long ago, they were actually colonists. And I just read that, I don't know if not the Spanish prime minister ridiculed the president of the United States, who claimed that Columbus actually provoked a lot of misery and devastation with the Native American Indians. And I think Biden is right. The president of the United States had the courage this time to acknowledge that the much celebrated Christopher Columbus actually ruined the Native American Indian way of life there in North America. And it's true. And we only celebrate Christopher Columbus, but we don't celebrate the vanquished, the defeated Native American, Native American Indians who didn't pollute the air, didn't create highways, didn't create all the modern so-called progressivist misery that we are so full of. Anyway, but it's good that finally an American president, he even proclaimed that the 11th of October, which is the day of, Christopher Columbus, should also be the day of the Native American Indians. And I think this is a positive move. During the day, the tower is backdropped by the city's coastline. In the evening, it's lit up by Vegas like LED lights. And there is a revolving restaurant at the top where diners can gaze out at the city and see. Of course, what diners? Not those diners who live in huts, but a privileged short percentage of the population. It's clear that, of course, there is corruption. There is import from the West. There are seductive things. It's known that the colonists used to seduce the so-called primitive people with, mirrors, pieces of glass, and corrupt them. The corruption goes on. Vegas-like, the Vegas is the corrupting city par excellence, and even Venturi was corrupted by Vegas since he wrote the book Learning from Las Vegas. There is nothing to learn from Las Vegas, absolutely nothing except to become morally and aesthetically corrupted. That's all. Now, this is very interesting, actually. And unfortunately, I didn't, I should have had a title for this. I had a book on this. It was offered to me. There is a very interesting futuristic architecture in Africa. So read about this. Modernist architecture is a defining feature of Eritrea's capital, Asmara. In 2017, it earned the entire city a UNESCO inscription. Arguably, the most iconic structure is the Fiat Taliero service station, which embodies the modernist tenets of function over flesh and the veneration of technology. Built in 1938 by Italian architect Giuseppe Petasi, who modeled it after an airplane, the station is also a rare example of futurist architecture realized outside of a theoretical context, though on the surface it resembles any Italian fascist design. Associate professor of architecture Edward Denison, whose work with the Asmara Heritage Project earned the city's World Heritage status, argues that such a structure could not exist in Europe or anywhere else. Between the local basalt used to construct much of Asmara and the Eritrean labor and craftsmanship required, The city's modernist architecture is uniquely African. If you peel away the skin, he says, of many of the city structure, you'll see they are actually quite traditional. This is what this person said. Well, I don't know. I mean, I don't know enough to pronounce myself in this, but it is it's essentially a gas station, you know. But yes, it is rather astute, it's audacious because of the cantilever part. It's remarkable, especially for the time when it was built. But it was an import, again, a futuristic Italian import. Beehive huts, these are the ones I prefer from Africa. And look at it, this is more, cleaned up and maybe too much. But it repeats a model that we saw in more genuine form, in my opinion, previously, and will continue to see. This vernacular architecture is defined by tightly woven grass coverings that are fitted on top of domed skeletons constructed out of thin saplings. They are adapted to the nation's hot climate by self-heating and cooling. Self-heating and cooling? These people are very sophisticated, depending on the season as well as protecting against rain. Historically, the number of huts owned by a family was indicative of socioeconomic status. Those Wazi beehive huts are in jeopardy of going extinct. Models of this traditional architecture can be found in wildlife sanctuary in whatever, Lobamba. Lideta Mercato, Ethiopia. Now, this is a modern building. As I said, this is an assemblage of samples of both old and new architecture from Africa. This is also, rather interesting. Anyway, let's read. Addis Ababa Lideta Mercato was named the world's best shopping center by the UNESCO Pre-Versailles Architecture and Architecture and Design Awards upon its completion in 2017. Well, it's a shopping center. The vision of architect Xavier Villalta is both sustainable and celebratory of Ethiopian culture and aesthetics, inspired by the old Mercato, the traditional open-air shopping center that once occupied the plot where it now stands. Lideta Mercato has a striking perforated outer wall that's reminiscent of the fractal patterns found in Ethiopian textiles. I do think that the textiles could influence our architecture in a very beneficial way. In general, this unique design also helps protect the structure against the harsh local climate by regulating natural light and ventilation. Moreover, the mall incorporates photovoltaic umbrellas to provide shade and create renewable energy, and rainwater is collected from the roof, filtered and repurposed for use in the building's plumbing. Now, the Ministry of Petroleum and Hydrocarbons, Gabon, my God, the Ministry of Petroleum. Wow. Well, nothing can be less sustainable than this. Through its function, through its appearance, through everything. The Ministry of Petroleum. Please allow me not even to read the text. Gambia National Assembly, the Gambia. Well, again, the modernization of Africa. This is not a stadium. It's actually an assembly hall, an assembly building, a renovated National Assembly building in 2011. And it was officially inaugurated in 2014. It was a large and expensive project that cost upward of 25 million to complete. As the nation's sole legislative chamber, it's fitting that the parliament building is monumental, with its crisp, cage-like roof sloping overhead, a solid core that resembles a straw basket. Well, it only resembles. Altogether, the complex main can house 400 guests. Let's look again. modernity in Africa. Let's move quickly to something else, but also modern, One Airport Square, Ghana. Yes, you know, I mean, this kind of picture could have been taken in many parts of the world today. I'm not going to read this. Casa Palabres, Guinea. You know, there is a certain naivete and idealism here, but I like more the grass around the building. I read though that the inside, let's read about the inside. Casa Palabres, which translate to house of words, nice wording, the house of words, was established as a meeting place in Dalaba, Guinea, a traditional territory of the Fula people of West Africa. It originally served as a hall for village elders to deliberate over important decisions. Though modest from the outside, the interior is covered in bas-relief, base relief designs with intricate motifs carved into the walls and floor. Palace of the People. I have to rush a little bit because we have another presentation about Dogon architecture and we still have 30 more buildings. I didn't know it takes so long to read this text. And anyway, another modern building. Please allow me not to insist. Imports African Heritage House, Kenya. Here also we see some colonial influences. It's not a bad building, I guess, but I don't feel like reading this. The Heritage House is dedicated to celebrating Pan-African art and culture. I always wonder why when we say art, we also say, and if we have both words, art and culture, usually we say art and culture, but art is not part of culture. You know, it's something strange here. Anyway, the Mokorotlo, Lesotho. You know, a modern interpretation of older models moving forward. I also, iconic buildings turn me off because they are again about the pyramidal hierarchical structure and not about the rhizomic structure, which requires modesty. But iconic or icons in general require, you know, falling on your knees in front of the icon. And that means submission and means, you know, servitude. The Grand Masonic Lodge, not to speak about the Grand, again, let's eliminate the word Grand for good, for a while at least, maybe not forever. And Grand it is. I mean, you know, Frank Masonry arrived even in Africa. Let's read a little about this. The Freemasonry refers to a brotherhood that was founded by medieval stonemasons. Chapters exist around the world to this day with many members of the Masonic Order of Liberia gathering in this grand lodge in Monrovia, the nation's capital. Though it fell into disarray for a number of years, the building was renovated in 2018 and is now in use once again. Leptis Magna, Libya. Well, this is from the Roman times. This is Roman culture. This is old, very, very old. And it's the sky, it's the sea, and there are the remnants of a culture which is very, very remote. Gazing out at the Mediterranean Sea from its vantage point on Libya's coastline is Leptis Magna, once a majestic city under the Roman Empire, that was largely developed by Emperor Septimius Severus. The entire site was awarded a UNESCO inscription in 1982 in an effort to recognize and preserve the ruins of the ancient city, which was added to the list of endangered World Heritage Sites in 2016. Among the archaeological marvels found at Leptis Magna are the Arch of Septimius Severus, Severan Basilica and sweeping amphitheater pictured above, that is here. Okay, moving forward, Rova of Antananarivo, Madagascar. Again, belonging to the pyramidal hierarchical structure, moving forward and quickly, MUA mission, Malawi. Again, you know, it's about power, it's about the pyramid, and it's not about the rhizomes. Moving forward, the great mosque of Jenne in Mali. Well, here is a different story, I think. This is considered the biggest and the best example of clay architecture. It's a mosque, but it's built of clay. And I think it's impressive. Let's read Mali's, and well, it happens that I like the architecture of Mali. Mali's great mosque of Djenne may be the most impressive mud structure anywhere on earth. It is the largest and the crowning achievement of West Africa's earthen Sudano-Sahelian architecture, which is characterized by its use of mud brick, adobe, and wooden beams that may stick out like spikes. Naturally, weather takes its toll on such structures. The current mosque in Djenne's historic old town was most recently reconstructed in 1907. And once a year during a festival known as Crépissage, the city's residents get together to replaster the great mosque. This is moving. And I don't know how old it is. It was refurbished in 1907, so obviously it's older than that. But we'll see many other examples of the architecture of Mali soon. Stone Tower of Chinguetti, Mauritania. You know, stone architecture, I don't think is particularly, you know, specific for Africa, but especially this kind of, you know, medieval tower. I have a feeling here there is some impure touches coming from the colonists. I'm not reading. Tient, then a pagoda, and the pagoda it is, but again, it's about the pyramidal structure, hierarchy, power, and publicity, the publicity for the religion it serves. I don't like it. I move forward. Bab Mansour Lalouj, Morocco. Well, from Morocco, we can find beautiful architecture, and it's famous for its architecture. And look at the ornaments that together with Adolf Loos, we totally banish from our buildings as if it is a nuisance, as if we cannot breathe, even breathe if we see, but we have to acknowledge. Compare the wall on the left or the wall on the right with what is in the middle. Now, which one is more sensitive and more impressive and more gentle? This one? Or this one? I think this one. Now, maybe I have a distorted psychology, but I prefer what I see here than what I see here. Architectural marvels are one of Morocco's trademarks, from Casablanca's Moorish Hassan II Mosque to Marrakesh Islamic El Bakia Palace. This intricately tiled gateway to in Meknes guards the entrance to place Plas El Hadim, named for architect El Mansour. This imposing structure has been standing since 1732, so almost 300 years. Its mesmerizing blue-green mosaics have been well preserved, if in need of polishing, and the Arab inscriptions scrolled across the top attest to the gate's beauty. Though the wooden doors no longer open, visitors may access the guarded square through a smaller passageway and will find exhibitions regularly hosted at the site. Let's look at it again. Beautiful are these ornaments from that time and earlier. A church of Saint Anthony of Polana, Mozambique. This is, almost an Eduardo Toroja building, reinforced concrete, modern. This Franciscan church in Maputo, aptly nicknamed the Lemon Squeezer, features a modernist style designed by Portuguese architect Nuno Craveiro Lopez, who built several notable structures in Mozambique and Angola. Completed in 1962, the church also has been likened to the works of Félix Candela, a founder of Mexican architecture and structural engineer, but Toroja as well, and compared to German expressionist architecture. Yes, in particular Otto Barning, if you want, you could see some resemblance to that. Inside is a dramatic vaulted ceiling with stained glass panels running up the tower and around the perimeter. Now, Christuskirche, in German, of course, Namibia. Please allow me to say nothing. Hikma Religious and Secular Complex, Niger. I like the new building here. And I think the architect is mentioned. Yes, Nigerian architect Mariam Kamara, founder of Atelier Masomi, has established herself, a woman, bravo, as one of the most celebrated figures in contemporary African architecture. This project saw a disused mosque in Dandaji transformed into a complex that's welcoming to all, complete with both a renovated mosque and a new library to promote literacy within the community. Nearly all of the materials used during construction were sourced locally, as it should, and the compressed earth bricks used in favor of traditional adobe increase sustainability by regulating heat and curbing maintenance. This is good. Let's look at it again. I saw other pictures of this building, and I think it is an excellent building, and it's rather recent. It's a new building, but it seems connected with the old culture of the place it finds itself in. And this, I think, is a value. The National Theatre, Nigeria. Now, please expect a Bulgarian megalomania here. It was built by the Bulgarians, I think. Yes, it is indeed, represented a form of centrality, which in my opinion should be obsolete by now. Nigeria's main performing arts establishment, the National Theatre in Lagos, was originally constructed for this festival in 77. The building also mimics the architecture of the Palace of Culture and Sports in Varna, Bulgaria. And yes, it was built by a Bulgarian firm. Okay. Tower, Republic of the Congo. Now, this is indeed a tower. I mean, we cannot contest this at all. Let's read. The tallest structure in the Republic of the Congo stares down the Congo River from nearly 350 feet up. Appropriately, it takes its name from the nation's tallest peak, Mount Nabemba. Construction ended on the 30th floor office in 1986 when the socialist government had big plans to invest in Brazzaville's development. It was rebuilt a decade later after being damaged during the construction, the country's civil war. Though a point of Congolese pride today, the tower is also the target of criticism due to its high upkeep costs, which have been cited as surpassing $3.5 million annually. Well, we have to pay for our vertical dreams. King's Palace, Rwanda. Let's read again. King's Palace, Rwanda. So when you read the word palace, you certainly don't expect this. But I like this. I like this very much. And you see, there is no door at the entrance. Beautiful. So one of Rwanda's great cultural landmarks, the King's Palace in Nyanza, is a recreation of an ancient royal residence from the days when Nyanza was the unofficial capital of the kingdom. I like anything unofficial, anything. There was someone who said, I wouldn't trust anything until it is unofficial. Anyway, the joke aside, I do like what is unofficial. I even thought of starting an architecture practice called unofficial. At its height, the town was home to as many as 2,000 Rwandans who lived in villages made up of huts bearing a similar beehive design. Also found on site are, Inyambo cattle said to be descendants of the herd kept by the king himself, which were traditionally dressed in jewelry and trained to participate in ceremonies praising the monarch. The cattle was dressed with jewelry. I guess, interesting, no? Anyway, let's move forward. I don't like palaces. Great mosque, Senegal. Great it is somehow through its dimensions, but it reminds me, unfortunately, of the Taj Mahal by former President Trump and Atlantic City and Las Vegas. Let's move forward. There are better mosques in the world. This is a temple. Temple indeed, but I prefer the Indian temples, the Hindu temples in India. This is rather new or painted in recent times. Not very noble in my opinion, sorry for being subjective. Martello Tower, Sierra Leone. This is kind of interesting. I don't know what is its function. Let's read. The British Empire erected the Martello Towers as defensive fortresses throughout the 19th century. Aha, so they are fortresses. Let's look at it again. Interesting, this meeting between stone and metal. With the invasive nature, which of course in the end has always the upper hand and the last word. I guess they were meant to protect against Napoleon's advances. By the way, this year there are 200 years since Napoleon died. The tomb of the unknown soldier, we are approaching the end with great speed. He might have been unknown, but the column is tall, very, very tall. It's an obelisk. To the countless soldiers who lost their lives. They are many indeed, countless soldiers and nameless soldiers who die for useless causes. This is a work by well-known architect in the present in South Africa. Now South Africa has money, so he just transformed an existing, industrial building into a museum. And the name, Thomas Heatherwick, he did a good job. This picture is maybe not as relevant as some others with this building. But remember the name. He is a very important, very publicized and rather exotic architect who even collaborated with Bjarke Ingels for the new headquarters of Google and so on. A very successful practice, Heatherwick Studio. Moving forward, South Sudan, Tukals in South Sudan. Maybe it's nostalgia from my part, but this is the kind of architecture that I admire the most, because this is the kind of architecture which is the most remote from what I see around me and from my own time and place. I understand we cannot build like this today because we are so many on this earth. But if we are serious about doing something about the climate and doing something about sustainability, maybe we can, whatever Bjarke Ingels says, that we shouldn't give up on the great comforts of our time. I think somewhere we do have to sacrifice certain things. We cannot continue to abuse the earth and claim at the same time that we are sustainable. No, it's not. No highway filled with thousands of cars every minute, if not every second, is sustainable. Not to speak about other things. In South Sudan, as much as 83% of the population, primarily represented by the Toposa people, live in traditional cottages called tukals. The beehive-shaped huts are made from mud and scrub brush, helped up by wooden frames that are woven together by twine or dinka rope and topped with thatched roofs. Also found scattered across the landscape are iconic Toposa granaries, which have a similar structure but are raised up on stilts. I read something similar before. And truly, I have to mention now Gottfried Semper, because Gottfried Semper thought that the first hut ever built, the first house, the first structure ever built by humans happened in this way. Some hunters and fishermen returned from work and they didn't have a home. They just had fire. And they understood that fire is immensely important to protect. So they didn't have tools to cut down trees and build, you know, erect poles or columns. So they just by hand, they removed branches of the vegetation around, and by weaving them, they created an enclosure, the walls. That's why Gottfried Semper thought that the first architectural gesture was weaving. Gottfried Semper was against Abbé Laugier, who thought that the first hut was made of poles and beams. And so it's, in my opinion, Abbé Laugier represents the masculinist conception about the first house, while Gottfried Semper represents the feminist conception of the first house. And in my opinion, and you see here, you know, these beehive-shaped huts are made from mud and scrub brush held up by wooden frames that are woven together by twine or dinka rope and topped with thatch roofs. Truly, I think the intuition of Gottfried Semper is correct. The first house was, the first architectural gesture was weaving. And in fact, the very word architecture, the second part of the word texture, comes from text, T-E-K-S, which in the Indo-European language means to weave. Please consider seriously this. Architecture has to do originally and genuinely and primevally with weaving. Weaving, yes, with textile work. And, you know, anyway, there is a lot to say about this, but let me continue. Now, we know the pyramids of Egypt, but there are other pyramids in Africa, and these are very impressive, although they are smaller. And for me, they are even more impressive because they are smaller. The Meroe pyramids in Sudan. Look at that. It happens that I like more the ruined ones. You know, but all in all, this is almost a surreal landscape. Well, it's also the beauty of the landscape, of the sand work, but also the structures that human beings like you and me, like us, built. These are unknown generally. We only know of those in Egypt. But look, in Sudan, there are also these remnants of a different kind of culture, which paid a lot of respect to the afterlife, because this is what they are about, the afterlife, that very afterlife that we neglect totally. What architect today is thinking of the afterlife? What architect, well, now maybe the pandemic is making us a little bit uneasy about this and we might change our mind. But for the past 50 years or so, if we move beyond the Brion Cemetery by Carlo Scarpa and, you know, a cemetery built by Aldo Rossi, in general, the contemporary architects neglected the afterlife, neglected cemeteries, neglected graves, neglected tombstones. But it was not in the past. And as you can see here, and this is very old, this is 5,000 years old. Can you believe it? Let's read. Mention pyramids in the same breath as African architecture, and most think of Egypt. Head south from Giza, however, you'll find an even greater number of pyramids situated along the banks of the Nile in Sudan, though smaller than their more famous counterparts. The forgotten Meroe pyramids are equally impressive and similarly served as royal tombs for the monarchs of the ancient kingdom of Kush. There are nearly twice as many Meroe pyramids, around 200 in total, the oldest of which dates back more than 400-500 years. Yes, now the Greek civilization that we are inspiring ourselves from, it's almost half as old, you know, from, well, you know, 2,000, a few hundred years ago. This is 400-500 years old. Tall and slender, they are an important example of Nubian architecture and earned Meroe a UNESCO nod in 2011. Let's look at them again. So they are in Sudan. Okay, and now we go to this dispensary. I don't know what it is in Zanzibar, but I don't have pictures. And yes, the site didn't have a picture for this either. I plan to search for it on the web, but I forgot. Sorry, now we go to the tower houses of Kutamaku in Togo. Why are they called tower houses? Well, I guess because of this. Little verticalities, if I am to call them so. I love these buildings, you know. And again, they didn't use the T-square and the rectangle. They didn't care about the famed long le droit of Monsieur Le Corbusier. They built it on the round. They built this on the round. And I wonder why, you know, if we claim all the time that we are too poor to build on the round. Well, these people, I guess, were richer than us. So they built on the round. Bravo to them. Togo. And look at the beautiful nature behind. And the building is not insulting nature. Nor is it insulting nature and I would say more than nature, perhaps even the local culture. As, sorry to be provocative now and controversial maybe, Tadawando insulted the Mexican culture when he built his famed concrete structures, and then he covered them with straw, you know, to mimic some kind of, affection for the local culture. Please, Mr. Tadawando, don't put straw on top of your polished concrete cubicles, please. You know, they don't work together, but here they do work together. Whatever is here and whatever is here, they work together. They belong together. Home to the Batamariba people of northeastern Togo and neighboring Benin, Kutamaku is a UNESCO recognized cultural landscape that's cherished for its takienta or traditional tower houses. The earthen dwellings often reach two stories and feature pointed thatched roofs. They reflect not only the harmony between man and nature through their use of local materials, as well as cultural cues like socioeconomic status, but have also become icons of Togo at large. Togo is a country neighboring Ghana. Hotel du Lac, Tunisia. This is a brutalist, import. Let's read. Tunisia's capital, Tunis, plays host to one of the world's finest examples of brutalist architecture, a mid-20th century modernist offshoot that's characterized by plain, blocky concrete constructions. Designed by Italian architect Raffaele Contigiani, and Habib Bourguiba, Tunisia's first post-independent president, the now abandoned hotel resembles an inverted pyramid and employs an impressive cantilever design. Some claim Hotel du Lac inspired the sand-crawled fortress in Star Wars. Well, what can we say? episode 4, A New Hope, which was filmed in Tunisia. All right, let's look at it again. Welcome on the African soil of the, these Europeans. Kasubi tombs, we are really very close to ending Uganda. Now, between a tomb and a house or even a king's palace, we see it's a very, very, very short distance. This could have been a king's palace or a hut for a humble person. All three functions could have been housed by this structure. So maybe indeed Bernard Tumi is right. Form follows fiction. Atop Kasubi Hill in the Kampala district of Uganda is a palace turned burial, so it was a palace, burial ground for the kings or kabakas and other royals from the Buganda kingdom. The main structure houses four royal tombs. Erected in 1882, it remains an active place of worship. Yet, according to its World Heritage inscription, the site's significance is also architectural, as Muzibu Azalama is entirely organic, made of wood, grasses, reeds, wattle, and daub. The Cathedral of the Holy Cross, Zambia, the mighty leader, God, this is built for the mighty leader. And it's not a bad building, actually, at all. I wonder who built it. Resembling a water tower, and this I like, you know. I mean, water means life, doesn't it? And, more than a traditional church, the Cathedral of the Holy Cross sits atop a hill watching over Lusaka, the Zambian capital, as the mother church of the city's Anglican diocese since 1962. The towering holy site has hosted regular Sunday service, but it doesn't say who built it. I actually kind of like it. As something of the architecture of Auguste Perret. Okay, and this is the last one from this series, East Gate Center in Zimbabwe. It's a contemporary building and it's rather interesting considering its function, which is commercial. Zimbabwean architect Mick Pierce drew inspiration from the Eastgate Center after seeing a video of David Attenborough walking among termite mounds in northern Nigeria. We use the termite or termite system as a kind of metaphor, citing the ways in which termite mounds moderate internal temperature and humidity. Though the Eastgate Center requires a small amount of electricity to cool the building through a fan and duct system, following a natural model enables significant energy saving by allowing Pierce, a sustainability-minded architect, to avoid using refrigerant-based air conditioning and incorporate efficient, eco-friendly lighting. Well, we don't see this actually in this picture, and I only have this picture, but also as an architect, I mean, you know, its aesthetics are rather interesting and kind of unexpected for, a shopping center. Okay, now we go to the second part of the presentation, if you are still here, the Dogon architecture, which to me is beautiful. Dogon architecture. Dogon architecture takes place in Mali, which is a little country neighboring with Ghana. Animals, stones, straw, earth. Then a building. I call it a building. Maybe it's just a storage space. You say, I couldn't live here because it's so much disorder and desolation. But I don't know. I mean, yes, probably life is not easy. How do you find food? How do you? Yes, it's difficult. But I think this settlement this human settlement. Again, if nothing else, what we see here is not something that is bringing upon us high temperatures and pollution. It is not. And it's indeed built with the local materials. And I wonder, these people need a psychoanalyst. They probably need some kind of medicine man, a shaman. The shaman lived in this house. Look at the shaman's house. Look at the elevation of the house. Could we build such a building today? No way. But I think there is a richness here which we can't even imagine. And in my opinion, a great problem with today's practice of architecture is that we don't consult ourselves. Actually, I thought of putting above this presentation a quotation from Einstein. Yes, Albert Einstein, who said that the intuitive side of our intelligence is the primary creative force, but we created a society which honors not it, but reason. And reason should be just a companion and a helper, but the main force should be that intuitive, dark, maybe dark, I don't know very well why I called it dark, side of our psyche. And that we don't explore and we don't externalize, but these people do. That's why I hope they need, I'm sure life there is not easy. Maybe it's more difficult for them than it is for us. But I feel tempted to think that they don't need a psychoanalyst. Well, I could be wrong, but they externalize their dreams. They externalize even their nightmares. Look at the elevation of this building. Again, something like this would be inconceivable for us. No modern architect to do something like this. The question is why? These people who build these buildings were humans and are humans, just like us. But why are they so different? Why do they put animals on the elevation of the building? We domesticate animals, but we never think of immortalizing them in this way. So look at this funny little hat above this funny, again, everything is on the round. No square, no right angles. I wonder why. Well, there are here some, but at least the hat is roundish. All in all, it's an architecture that is, in my opinion, valuable as culture. Maybe from my point of view or our point of view, not as valuable in terms of so-called civilization. But we cannot deny the aesthetical charm of what we look at. And the imaginative way of building, it's in my opinion, these buildings are much richer, not just aesthetically, but psychologically, than our square buildings. I'm tired of our square buildings, our rectangles, our obsession with reason again, functionalism and reason. But these people were never trained as architects, but they built based on the tradition of the place, and they built with local materials. This is entirely a so-called sustainable architecture. Now I understand we cannot live like this. Do we see any car here? Do we see any parking lot here? Do we see any highway here? No, we don't. Of course, apparently we cannot live like them. Yet they are humans just like we are. And even here, this is maybe a little storage cell, it has some decoration on it. And I wonder why. Why didn't they leave it just a blank wall? Well, there must have been a reason why. And look at this elevation of this building. why was there a need to, you know, do this ornamental design on the doors and at the top of the building? And, you know, even here, you know, it seems it is an innate need and desire in the human being to embellish. And I don't think these people were criminals, as Mr. Adolf Loos said, because they had this desire for essentially for contemplation. I don't think so. In fact, I feel like writing an article myself called Structure and Crime, as opposed to ornamental and crime. And look at the proud inhabitant of this interesting building. Look at the waves of the facade. Yes, I idealize it perhaps, but look at the shades, and it's a very modest building. You know, it's almost, it doesn't deserve. No, I shouldn't say so. It's a very modest structure. I shouldn't say structure either. Building. Look at this, but it's poetical. It's yes, it is sustainable, it is local, it is an affectionate building, you know. It's, why is it we cannot be like this any longer? And because obviously we can't. L'architecture d'Ogon, construction en terre au Mali, building with mud, with clay. Look at this also, d'Ogon, Mali. It's a surprising architecture, I think, you know. It's, and look how they announced the entrance with the simplest of means, just some splashing some white paint left and right and a little bit at the top, with a very, the most modest gesture, something we wouldn't do, of course, or if we do it, we have to draw a rectangle here and use the T-square and the rectangle, or AutoCAD and ARCHICAD and so on. These people work with nothing of the sort, and they created a building which is both rational and irrational. And I think it's very fine, as this one is, and I envy them from an architectural point of view. And yes, there were no architects there. There was no Alberti. There was no signature architect. They built it together, maybe some master builders from the area. This is another, building of the Dogon, I would say complex architectural culture. I think we can learn from these people. Again, look at the entrance. You know, it's a hole in this facade, in this elevation, and then the splashed whiteness. You know, very almost avant-garde. You know, only an avant-garde artist or architect to do something like this today. No so-called cultured, formally trained architect would allow himself or herself to just splash some white, color on the left and the right. But these vulnerabilities, these imperfections actually are generating the charm of the structure, a charm which we cannot arrive at through rational means. I'm sorry. Now here we have the excesses of the shaman. You know, this is the medicine man, is a special figure in the village. And I wonder what he feels. I wonder what he thinks. You know, why is he so different from me and us? You know, why is he adorning the elevation, the facade, with objects, which with private, you know, possessions, mainly of an artistic nature, or little skulls, or, all kinds of things that he uses actually in his shaman's services. Interesting and totally unknown to us. And look at this. What is this? This is not Acropolis. This is not Athens. This is not a temple, or is it not? And, you know, again, why the need for ornamentation and narration? because there is also narration here. This is the something is being said here, it's being told. As for what is at the top, I think it's magnificent. So I envy them. I think the imagination, the poetry of these, we cannot match with our ridiculously sterile, white, rational and rationalistic and functionalist things. Really, we can't. In terms of imagination and in terms of the so-called unconscious, we are almost non-existent. Even this, you know, and this is built by anonymous builders who knew the craft of erecting a building from the local culture with local materials and so on. Nobody taught them. No Neufert, no books, no many years, six or whatever in high ending, high ends, the superior places of learning. And they built, look what's here. Why did they do this? Why is this part of the world? Now, of course, the reptile is part of the environment. But why did they verticalize it? Why? And there is so much richness here and surprises. Now, maybe they would be equally surprised when they see our cities. It's possible. I don't know. I like the Dogon culture. I like the hats of these buildings here. And they seem to be so much at home in the landscape. If they were not growing from the earth upwards, as Frank Lloyd Wright asked us to have our buildings do, but they do seem to belong to this place, ephemerally or maybe ephemerally, but what is not ephemeral, actually. And now we'll see some pictures of people. People of that culture, of those settlements, adorn themselves in highly decorative, well, it's true, for certain celebrations. But they are so different from us. Look at them. First, look at the colors. You know, why did they like color? See, they have no shoes, but they don't need shoes there. And look at them, masks. We have something like this when it's, you know, Balu Bobocilor, perhaps to an extent. But that's an isolated event, one day a year. And here you have, it's part of a society at large, not a specific, you know, a group of within a university. This is it's part of a local culture, and I wonder why did they need this richness of colors and you know this figuration, these masks. They are enacting something that is so strange for us, you know, because we reduced life to a set of stereotypes, you know, is our life are so removed from our so-called unconscious. But these people, the theater I don't know if every day, of course they had to earn a living too somehow, they have to survive. But what made them, what makes them also bring the theater at this level within the poverty of their environment? You know, these are not rich people. How come they needed culture? Because this is culture. Why the need for it? And in the villages in Romania, in the old villages, and in, you know, there are manifestations of this sort as well. And I think they are very important, even for architecture. After all, you know, I remember the picture with architects in New York dressing up as a Chrysler Building or Empire State Building. Well, this is not dissimilar. It's the same thing, except that there is more color here and in a way more sincerity and more genuineness, I would say. very interesting. The same people who build those buildings that we saw, and we are going to see a few more, adorn themselves in this way. And here they are dancing. Why are they dancing? And I would ask, how many of us dance on the streets? Not many. Maybe we dance in dancing halls. Now with the pandemic, we dance, you know, rather alone in our rooms, if we dance at all. But to dance, you know, outside, on the streets, in the parks, in squares, you know, dressed or undressed, who cares? To dance, to mask ourselves, we don't do this sort of thing. We think we are too serious, too mature, too emancipated to do this sort of thing. If you do something like this today, you would be considered mad. Well, in that part of the world, something like this is probably even sacred. And look at this. You know, with simple means, you can create exceptional events. With simple means, you can become the acrobat that Le Corbusier wrote a little poem about, doing exceptional things. And you don't need to go to the mall and buy the latest gadgets or whatever. You just need to use your imagination. And with whatever is around you, you can create the otherness of art, because that's what it is about. Even at the poorest level, art and artistic expression are necessary. That's why these people, you know, create this, this spectacle and this, you know, this theater, this choreography, which I find is very enticing aesthetically. Bravo to them. Really, bravo to them. I mean, like children can play using their own imagination with anything, with little stones, with anything. They don't need a paraphernalia of capitalist production and consumption, you know, the endless process of, you know, giving the children already made things so-called scientifically, so they can't use any longer their imagination. These people use their imagination. And this is what they create. They dance, and they dance madly. They don't know about Apollo, they don't know about Dionysus, but they dance. And I also think, you know, in my opinion, they are purer than us. They are more innocent than us. You could call them naive. I don't know who is more naive, actually. Them or us, with our white shirts and ties and our strict programs from 9 to 5 and our boring working days, Monday to Friday. And then in the weekend, we explode. Well, not so much now with the pandemic, but usually every worker on this earth who works from 9 to 5, Monday to Friday, can't wait for the weekend to arrive. Or the vacation, to finally get wild. These people are probably wild every day. They don't need a weekend. They don't need a vacation. And look at them. And they are together. This is beautiful. They are together. Something we forgot to do and to be. Bravo to them. I admire them. Will beauty save the world, as Dostoevsky said? Perhaps. They are enacting something here that we totally forgot. That something, what is that something? I think is within us, in our unconscious. But we don't express our unconscious. If we can learn anything from Africa still, is that to learn, to descend within ourselves and explore that part of ourselves which usually we do we ignore, and they don't. Back to architecture, and we'll end soon our presentation. We already saw this building, and here are foundations for another building or three buildings. I think diminishing a little the the stringencies of Its Majesty reason could benefit us. Mud building, we saw this picture before. This one we didn't see, but you see, this is a mature culture. It's not this is not just an improvisation done by who knows who. There is knowledge here, you can tell. There is a coherence, but also a richness and even a rigor that shows sophistication, shows culture, a sedimentation of knowledge. Cliff dwellings. There are plenty in Mali. And again, why ornament here? Why didn't leave it blank? Why did they spend their time here, doing this? Well, why is a grandmother who is, weaving, embroidering something is using ornaments often on a sweater or even on a sock. There is an innate desire to embellish works with something. Even nature has this. How else to explain the beauty and the complexity of the design of the wings of a butterfly or the tail of a peacock. Like John Ruskin said, and I keep repeating this, he said that the most beautiful things in the world are also the most useless. And he gave us an example, the tail of the peacock and the lily. But they were also builders. I mean, these buildings stand. They stand. They respect, the laws of gravity and static requirements and so on, without going to years of study and so on and learning formulas. It's a hands-on approach to the art of building. And I think they are doing well for themselves. Now I know I idealize what I do not have, but isn't this not normal? I wonder what these people feel, when they live inside these structures, and in the morning perhaps they emerge out of this in this case, rather cubical, but not completely cubical. You see these imperfections, that this is not perfectly vertical. It's, the approximations of trunks of pyramids. And so there is an organicity here, even when geometry is used. you know, and I remember, anyway, I shouldn't mention this. I love this, you know, I really love it. I don't think this is inferior to the Parthenon in Athens. I know what I'm saying is probably unacceptable, but to me, this is not inferior to the Parthenon by Ictinos and Callicrates. I repeat it, and I stand by my statement. I love it. It's innocent, it's mysterious, it's simple and complex at the same time. It's okay, we live in the present, it's sustainable. I don't know its function, but it's probably, you know, not destined just for, it has a transcendental function, perhaps. Some people might use the word sacred. It's possible, but I like it very much. And this is how it was built, with these materials, you know, stones, straw, mud, meaning clay. This is another kind of similar structure, adorned also with interesting things which belong to their culture, to their, you know, mythology. I envy them. Compare this with almost any building, any private house that we build today. Just compare it if you can. This is richer. It is richer. And so are these, you know, we don't use sculptures. We don't adorn our buildings with sculptures. There are artists who have nothing to eat, have nothing to work, and we ignore them. The architect ignores them, and thus ignores also Walter Gropius and his Bauhaus Manifesto, where he says, artists, painters, sculptors, architects should come together, and we do not come together. No, we are not even taught to come together, and we don't even think of coming together. And that's a great loss. Look at these so-called primitive people, where they are not primitive at all. In my opinion, we are primitive by comparison. Well, there are things here that we might protest against because we think we are decent. Well, actually, they are the innocent ones, not us. Good work, Dogon. Good work. You are teaching us a lesson about culture, about artistry, about living gently on the earth, recognizing the mystery of creation, and trying to respond as creatively as possible to that mystery of creation. And this is also a narrative architecture, because there is narration here being told on these wooden pillars of this structure. I don't know the symbolism, I don't know the mythology, but I'm sure a story is being told. What story do our white buildings whisper? No story at all. We don't even think of our building telling a story. Dogon, Mali. Dogon, Mali. Well, you see on the right a motorcycle. What can we do? You know, it's inevitable that, you know, certain things coming from the so-called civilized world will reach this place. But the motorcycle passes in a rush by this structure, this building, but maybe the poet stops and thinks and tries to absorb and ask himself the question, what made these people build in this way? Maybe they, without reading Heidegger, in a deeply felt way, they live and work and create under the sky, as Heidegger asked us to do, and on the earth. Toguna. The Toguna is a type of building in Togo and other in Mali also. Toguna. This is how it is called. You can find on the web, you search for Toguna, and you can find on Wikipedia a lot of information about it, which I didn't yet read, But I like what I see. Look at these columns, you know, what would the modern engineer say? Would say this is nonsense. You know, don't try to fool me with these artistic carvings of the columns. We only use round columns, white and plain, and the same in section from bottom to the top. Well, this is an organic culture here. And in my opinion, much more complex than ours, culturally speaking. Toguna. Did they have structural engineers there? They didn't need structural engineers, you know, doctors in engineering. No, they had a local craftsman who knew how to erect this. And it's another beautiful African Parthenon, and this one as well. I think Ictinos and Callicrates, if they were honest, if they were sincere, they would have acknowledged that the builders of this African Parthenon were their equals. This is a ceremonial structure, ceremonial building. We don't have too many ceremonial constructions today in this sense, you know, deeply felt and where it, in a Freudian sense, would manifest itself with all its, you know, depths, psychological depths. And this is a, you know, some kind of a sacred structure, if you believe it or not. I like it. It's dreamlike. It's innocent. It's idiosyncratic. It's other par excellence. This one as well. Much richer than our white little buildings. I am tired of the white walls, you know, all stereotypically done in the same way, rigid and frigid and sterile. Look, a detail of the on these oblongs. Well, the person living here or who did this is probably not Auguste Rodin or Brancusi, but it doesn't matter. In his or her, maybe his anonymity, he created something for a specific building, and I think it works. This is part of a society and part of a culture where the active life and the contemplative life are blended together, melting into each other. They come together. So the world of what we call the real and the world of what we call the dream are organically and very, very intimately intertwined. Dogon, Mali. Thank you.